Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here. We're live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake and also live in St. Paul over SPNN. Glad to have you here. We got a lot of family law issues today, and we're going to start local, statewide, with some of this family law, and then we're going to look at some of the national issues going on in Houston and see a video of a girl, a seventh grader, who spoke before the school board, really did a super job about some abuse she was taking by a teacher. Then we're going to go to the U.S. Supreme Court Justice Kennedy when he was asked a question about whether government officials have to, it wasn't whether they have to follow the law or not, but what moral obligation do they have to follow the law if it violates their freedom of religion? He really put Kennedy in a bind, this guy that asked this question. And Kennedy, I think Kennedy figured it out, but Kennedy had to resort to cheap shots. This is a Supreme Court justice in order to wiggle out of that. Got some updates on the Grazini-Rukki case, just to let you know. She's on her way back to Minnesota. She left Florida, I believe, on Friday, is my understanding. Has not been seen yet. Should have a court hearing date within 48 hours of being in Minnesota, but her attorney hadn't been notified of any, so it's interesting what's going on. Is now Sandra missing? Who knows? We don't know. How difficult it is to get information and get protection when you're in custody, it's really hard, even if you're an attorney. And especially if the state wants to be difficult, and they can. And that's why the state has sued so many times, because they just kind of do what they want to do. So the Supreme Court justices expect us to do what they want us to do, tell us to do, but they won't do it themselves. All right. Hey, laws get passed. And laws get signed, and there's a certain time period, but sometimes you have ceremonial signing of bills. And a couple weeks ago, Governor Dayton, I had a ceremonial signing of a family law bill. I want to show this to you because it kind of lays out the players who are involved in the family law discussions. These are the people that are making the decisions, and you could be there too in that process, but how they get there, what it takes to get there, you'd be surprised. So not much, but then on the other hand, there's a lot of work that's done, a lot of bargaining and a lot of back and forth that goes on. So we're going to see Governor Dayton ask some questions and also kind of get a picture of what's going to happen in the coming up legislative session regarding family law. So let's roll that video here.
Hi, Mike Tipper. Hi, Governor.
Good to see you.
Thanks for
having
me. Nice to see you.
Hi,
Melinda
Huckdoll
from Legal Aid.
Nice to see you.
Thank you for all the work you did
on
this. I know this
I missed you.
Oh, good to see you.
Sure. Nice to meet you.
I know this is at Loggerheads for great job of pulling all through. Thank you.
I've been there for a long time.
Yeah, well, sometimes it takes a while. Pretty emotional issue. I went through it myself once, and so I know there's experience how emotionally fraught it is.
Yeah.
So this is, I'm not going to re-sign it. I've already signed it, as you know, but anyway, this is a momento of vacation. So.
Thank you.
If the legislature funded our budget, we can afford to pay it. Otherwise, I'd have to ask for them back. Thank you very much.
The Sharpie company,
thanks. That's
you.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
That's right. term, yes.
Thank you.
Not a lot of sound value to these ceremonies for cable purposes, but.
I'm good.
Okay. So what's next on the agenda? Is this one taken care of now, or are you getting another round?
Child's what's next?
Guidelines on how they give advice to parents on custody issues.
Uh-huh.
So revise those guidelines and take care of child support. Big jobs.
Yeah. So how the courts advise parents what to.
There's a Supreme Court guideline, parenting guidelines, and it hasn't been addressed for what?
20 years.
20 years. So we're going to revamp it, make it up to date.
All in the next session, or are we?
Actually, over the next year, probably. Maybe you'll be handling the lead on that.
There was a task force, wasn't there, before the?
Yes.
Is the same group going to work on this next round? Are you going to bring a new?
Nope, some new blood.
New blood, okay.
But she was on it first one.
Okay.
We also have cooperative private divorce that is making some sway. That is involved in.
Cooperative private divorce, isn't that an actual round?
Good call.
Well, helping people to do the right thing, you know, rationally, and especially with the best interest of the children while you're, you know, involved with all the emotional people. That's a very challenging, but very, very, very important.
That's probably the most important thing we did as a group, is to refocus the attention on the best interests of the child,
yeah,
rather than who's the best parent.
We all rallied around that.
Yeah.
And working on continuing to work on clarifying what exactly those changes mean, mm-hmm, to ensure consistent application, because that's been an issue.
Probably the best custody statute in the country, I think.
There you go.
Really?
Unique, yeah, in the nation.
Better factors now for updated factors for dealing with custody. This century.
Hopefully next we'll have the child support. The department is hosting us for the meetings with an economist, so the human services, so they've been great.
Good.
Working with us.
And then you have to figure out how to collect them after they've been.
Right.
And the group also includes consumers, like Brian here.
Mm-hmm.
He's the representative of people that have been through the agreement,
mm-hmm,
working for change.
Everybody said you've been involved as a personal experience, but those are important too, because, mm-hmm, they are about the rest of everybody's life, the kids and the parents.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
For the long haul, for decades to come, not just during that,
yeah,
part of time.
For sure.
I appreciate your help in spurring the ideas.
Well, I think it was, you know, again, from my own personal experience, I know how important it was and still is. And
but your putting out the call for all of us to come together was really instrumental in all of us coming together,
yeah,
and,
yeah,
working.
Well,
so
then there was more than a little doubt at the start that it,
yes,
would work.
Yes. You gave me the call, and you said, well, I think, you know, everybody, yeah, can come to the table. I said, well, yeah, I was not real confident. Do you remember that phone call? I'm like, well, okay, we'll try it.
The ones who pulled it off, it's easy to have a suggestion, but yeah.
And another important aspect is the circle, the facilitator that came from California.
Oh, really?
She facilitates,
yes,
circles.
Good.
And restorative,
and she was
justice circles,
good,
amazing process.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Long before this, I've been involved in them. Seriously, families
figure
as well
out where we could employ that in other,
exactly,
other matters, mm-hmm, the person that could,
yes,
get the name. Can you get the name of whoever,
yeah,
sure,
it is, that would be,
mm-hmm,
worth knowing.
Yeah, very good.
She's,
yeah,
extremely,
she's
good.
Good.
Yeah.
The large public policy issues.
Yeah, well, I definitely take a look at that.
This was actually her first crack at a legislative issue like,
mm-hmm,
this.
Huh.
And so it was charting new ground for her too, and I think she's kind of writing some papers on it, and,
mm-hmm,
and so it was a really a learning experience for all of us, really.
How is she with copper nickel mining?
She took
on family law.
I mean,
yeah,
she did. You can't get any more contentious than that. So
I did think of that. you know, if we could come to some agreement that that could work out better, where we could get jobs but not pollute everything.
I'll get people to listen to one another. People's minds are made up, and so it's like, you know, you're the devil incarnate, you know.
But that's not unlike what we went through. Exactly.
When we dug down, we found the common ground, and it was, I surprised all of us how much of it there was.
And the facilitator from California, Mickey Cashton, she's got a real gift on making sure that everybody, no matter how polarized, feels heard and understood, not only by her, but by each other as well. So that's an incredible process.
That's an amazing skill, huh?
Yeah, it is.
I'll look into that, for sure.
All right, thank you.
I don't know what I'd do, we, want me to suggest any other task force?
Oh, you got it.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, that was quite a, if you realize all the work that it took to get these very opposing people together and to come up with the changes that they came up with. I don't know that I'd agree with Mr. Ditburner there that this is the best custody factors in the nation, but it definitely improved and clarified Minnesota's wordings of the child custody factors. However, the judges in Minnesota, at least a few of them, are not getting it. And they've already made rulings in Minnesota that go against what the law is. Of course, judges can do that. They can make whatever decision they want to make, even though there's a law there. It just doesn't matter. They have immunity. If you don't like what they did, you get to appeal it. Go through that process. But it was really a huge step in the right direction. And it sounds to me like they found a really good facilitator to get these groups together. Now the question is, why isn't this happening in the legislature? Why does not this discussion and debate take place? Not necessarily a debate, but a discussion with a facilitator that can get both sides talking to discover the common issues. Well, it can. And it really depends a lot on who is the chair and who and how they behave and how they do their meetings. But their meetings are very, very limited in time and scope, and they have a lot of things to discuss. So a lot of the discussion takes outside the hearing rooms, and it takes groups of people who have an interest in what is going on getting together outside the legislature. And you know, the legislature gets to know who's on what side. They know that. You know, they know who's for what and who's against what, and who's for families, who's against them. I mean, basically, you saw kind of a split there. You had four people who I would consider on the DFL side who fought any type of strengthening of parental rights. And actually still fight strengthening of parental rights. But in the bottom, and then you had the Republican side that was representative there, people more leaning Republican, saying, hey, parents need to be involved in this. And then Dayton just brought them together only for the reason that he felt the pain. In my mind, he felt the pain of divorce, knew the problem with it, knew something needed to be resolved, and wasn't satisfied with what was happening in the legislature. Neither was I, you know, and I don't like that he vetoed our bill in the way that it happened, but it did, but he got people together, and he just made one criteria: whatever you agree on, you know, that's what I'll sign, all the parties, you know. And I know you guys don't work well together, and you don't like what how the family law is, and you have a different perspective. But evidently, this mediator, facilitator, was able to get these people to find out the common ground. Now, that being said, there is still a lot of uncommon ground there that will take one party in power to change that uncommon ground that will strengthen family law. and strengthen parental rights. And so that you just don't get your kids taken away from you on a whim. And that even though you're a non-custodial parent, you're still a parent with constitutional rights. We don't have that here in Minnesota. If you get deemed to be the lesser of the two parents, you're out. You know, you lose constitutional rights. So that this is going on is a good deal, and there's been a lot of good work done, and it will continue to go. As they were saying, child support task force is going on, which again could use a good mediator or moderator or facilitator. And the child custody, revamping the child custody laws in relationship to the Supreme Court ruling on when a child could stay overnight with a parent. You know, at what age can a child stay overnight with a father and be safe? Just unbelievable stuff. And in Minnesota, it's really bad. Some states, 6 years old. That's just bogus. A child could stay overnight as a baby with a father. Fathers and men are more than capable of dealing with that. So a lot of work to be done there. Okay, nationally, and this parental thing will come back into play because it's a freedom in our discussion, but something happened in Houston and has been going on for quite a while, in that the mayor of Houston was trying to get an ordinance going relating to who can be in what bathroom. And in this case, if you identified as a transgender male, you can go into a woman's bathroom. And you had to be verified, but just in order to be able to do that. And some places have passed this type of ordinance, some cities have. And Houston wanted to put it in place, but they did not allow a vote, as was to be allowed by the Constitution of Texas. This ordinance needed to be voted on by the people. The city of Houston did not do it, and the lesbian mayor there, Anise Parker, was thwarting the law in any way she could. And so some of the five area Houston pastors spoke against this law. At least five stood up and sued the city, and the Supreme Court of Texas agreed with them in a unanimous decision. But in the process of that being sued, the mayor then subpoenaed all the pastor sermons, data files, computer files, tape recordings, anything that they had regarding their speaking out against this ordinance. So we're going to see a video here that kind of gives a background on this and the Houston mayor. So we'll see this video. It's by CBN. Christian Broadcasting Network. I think it's a pretty good summary, so let's watch that.
Houston officials are trying to intimidate Christian pastors.
Five conservative pastors who were served subpoenas.
This cannot be happening in America.
In September 2014, the city of Houston served five subpoenas to five Houston pastors demanding their sermons.
It all stems from the passage and attempted repeal of a controversial ordinance that would allow, among other things, people of either gender to enter men's or women's restrooms based on the gender they most identify with.
October 9th, Alliance Defending Freedom filed a motion to quash the subpoenas. October 13th, ADF issued a headlining press release, "Houston, we have a problem," which garnered national attention. October 14th, Mayor Parker tweets, "Sermons are fair game." Meanwhile, the media was reporting that the city was backing off. October 15th.
No, there's no question the wording was overly broad. One word in a very long legal document, which I know nothing about and would never have read.
ADF responds.
With all due respect, there's no one that knows the mayor or the city attorney who would believe that they did not know about those subpoenas until yesterday.
And contrary to the media reports, the city's not backing off. The mayor actually tweeted on her page that if the pastors were talking about this issue from the pulpit, their sermons are fair game.
October 16th, ADF again issues a press release saying the city is not backing off. Senator Ted Cruz rallies with local pastors and condemns the mayor's abuse of power.
And when you subpoena one pastor, you subpoena every pastor. The city of Houston has no power, no legal authority to silence the church.
October 17th, the city revises the subpoenas by dropping the word sermons.
So is this their way of shifting things around for PR purposes and still getting what they want?
It's total political shenanigans. They are still demanding that these pastors turn over 17 different types of communication.
Even the ACLU of Texas disagrees, stating, the government should never engage in fishing expeditions into the inner workings of a church. The liberal Houston Chronicle opposed the mayor's actions. Meanwhile, ADF continues to barrage the media with stories about the pastors involved.
You know, I feel like they want to send us a message that you speak up and you pay.
And because we spoke and we used the First Amendment freedom of speech, they're trying to stop us from speaking. They're trying us to cover our mouths like this.
Atheist lovers of freedom will be as repulsed by this as the most devout Christian.
October 23rd, ADF announces the U.S. Civil Rights Commissioner has advised the city to withdraw the subpoenas and warned of its chilling effect on religious and political speech. Also, plans are made for a November 2nd rally in Houston. October 29th.
After much contemplation and discussion, I am directing the city legal department to withdraw the subpoenas issued to the five Houston pastors.
So this is another attack on Christianity, very clearly. It's another bullying attempt at people of faith.
If we tolerate this kind of abrogation of religious freedom in this nation, all of our liberties will be unraveled.
This was their plan all along they just thought no one would stand up and say anything.
Well, good job for standing up and saying something. The vote was held, and it was a 62-38 repeal of that decision by the Houston City to have this ordinance. The problem with this ordinance is that, and what's happened in other cities is that men who have registered as transgender and have been officially certified as transgender have gone into women's bathrooms and then assaulted women. And there's been at least a couple cases that I know. One guy went in and raped two women in the women's bathroom. So you just don't need this stuff. And this, you know, understand these are the bullying tactics that a city or a school board or people can do, and there's just no need for this. But the good news is that these pastors who stood up, because they stood up, this ordinance was overturned, and you know it helped that certain atheist groups realize what was at stake for them too, their loss of freedom of speech. The ordinance was also going to promote, force businesses to promote messages about sex and marriage that are contrary to their religious beliefs. The law would allow men and women's restrooms and locker rooms, and it's just not needed. It's the bottom line with that. It's interesting to note who was in favor of this ballot measure, and a number of corporations financed and pushed this ballot measure. Some of them were Apple Computer, BASF, Dell, Hewlett-Packard. So that's three of the big computer industries. Dow Company, General Electric, United Airlines. United Airlines gave $100,000. Or $10,000 was given by United Airlines to support that gender inclusiveness into society by having men in women's bathrooms based on their feelings, because every single cell of that man's DNA is male. There's nothing, no female DNA in that man. Same with a woman. If they think they're a man, every single cell is female. Okay? And so that then relates, there's a mental problem going on. They don't like who, they may not like who they are, they may not accept who they are, but it is who they are. And they are not coping with the reality, which is too bad. And it hurts them. So we have a, and somebody text in here, you can surgically, like Bruce Jenner did, you know, you can alter yourself, you can put some fake breasts in, you can change your hair color, you know, you can take some hormones, but you can't change their DNA, okay? So it's a big deal. But also going down in Houston here, is a little girl who was being persecuted by her teacher for believing in God. And we're going to show that video of her standing up to the school board, the seventh grader. So let's see what she has to say.
You have 5 minutes to speak to us. If you don't want to use that time, you don't, just as much as you want.
Today I was given an assignment in school that questioned my faith and told me that that God was not real. Our teacher had started off saying that the assignment had been giving problems all day, and we were asked to take a poll to say whether God is fact, opinion, or a myth, and she told anyone who said that a fact or opinion was wrong and that God is only a myth. And she started saying, telling kids that they were completely wrong, and that when kids would argue, she had told them that we would get in trouble. And whenever we asked why we were led to believe that he was true, if he is untrue, she told us to ask our pastors. When I tried to argue, she told me to prove it. And I tried to reference things such as the Bible and stories that I've read before from people that have died and went to heaven but have come back and told their stories. And she told me that both were just things that people were doing to get attention. And I know that it wasn't just me who was affected by it. My friend, she went home and she started crying. And she was actually supposed to come with me, but she didn't think she could. So my friend, she turned in her paper, and she had still put that God was a fact and to be true. And my teacher crossed the answer out several times, telling her that it was completely wrong. And one of my other friends, she got really upset, and she started arguing with the teacher, and the teacher got mad. And my friend, she wound up slamming everything off of her desk because she got really aggravated with the whole issue. And whenever my friend and I came home, we immediately told our parents about it, and we called the principal, and she said that she would handle it, but she said that the teacher had already gone home. And another child in my class had asked the teacher if we could, like, try to put what we believe in on the paper, and she said, you can if you want to get the problem wrong, which will fail. You'll fail the paper if you do. And I felt like this was really wrong, and I didn't feel like it was fair for for my faith and my religion to have anything to do with what I'm learning about in school. And I had known before that I know that our schools aren't really supposed to teach us much about religion or question anything about religion. And when I tried to talk to my teacher about it, she told me that it doesn't have anything to do with religion, because the problem was just saying that there is no God.
Mr. Frady.
Thank you. First of all, thanks for coming tonight. I'm truly sorry that you feel your faith was questioned. As you point out, the principal was made aware of this today, and we'll have a chance to work on that as per district policy and procedures. So thank you for coming tonight. We will definitely be looking into that. Very much appreciate it. Very brave of you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, honey. Good job, honey.
Yes, thank you, Ms. Jordan. Oh, we have one little quick question.
Clarifying, I may have missed it. What grade were you in again?
I'm in seventh grade.
Seventh grade. Okay, thank you.
Mr. President, clarifying question.
Mr. DeBrow.
What school?
I'd rather we not have that at this point in time. You have a resolution process that we need to follow. And I think getting into these details right now would be violating your own process. It would be unfair to a lot of folks, and putting her on the spot is not a good thing. My recommendation.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr.
Very brave of you. Thank you.
Yeah, so let's see. The teacher says there is no God. Understand this. There is no God. Therefore, it can't be a question about religion. Because there's no God, therefore there's no religion. So this isn't a question about religion. That's what I understood the girl there to say to the teachers or to the school board there. That's the Katy Independent School District. I mean, that she at seventh grade can figure that out and articulate that is something else. Pretty good. They were taking a poll. Okay, why are they taking a poll? And is this poll being recorded? Is it being added as data to this child's records? So this is a big issue with Common Core and their data collection, because they're trying to collect data on you. This isn't about necessarily data on the child, but it's about data on the parents, because usually what a child believes comes from the parents and what the parents are teaching, okay, until a certain age, and then all bets are off, you know. So this is about data collection and having a record of the parents and the child in the school system. And that's why you got to oppose Common Core, because that's what it's about. One of the issues is collecting data, so the government has it on you. Okay. So the teacher saying that God is a myth, that's the right answer, you know, crossing out the word and saying, you know, God is not a fact. You know, that this type of indoctrination, and then she this girl talks about it right again, in the aspect of trying to teach this, that this teacher is giving it as a, it's not a question, it's teaching. What the teacher is doing is teaching there. So the teacher isn't asking a question. They're telling the students how they have to answer this question. You get the indoctrination there. I thought it was also interesting that the school board, first one of the persons there said, we're sorry to hear that you feel your faith was questioned. It wasn't a feeling. Her faith was questioned, and her faith was challenged in a hard way that shouldn't happen in a public school. It's not about, the school isn't to teach religion, nor is it to question religion. okay? Because you have the free exercise of religion, and the state is also not to sponsor religion, okay? So in this sense, her faith was flatly denied. The school board also would not name the name of the school or the names of the teacher involved, and wouldn't let her do that, even though one school board member tried to do that. Of course, you see that in all school boards, and which is totally, you know, if the school board was up there, if a school was up there and something good happened, they would tell everybody, hey, this good happened at this school, and this teacher, look at the accomplishments here, okay? But when it comes to bad information, they shut it down. And you know what? That's wrong. But that's what's being taught everywhere. And that's why St. Paul Schools doesn't want the film, the public comments, because people might hear bad things about the St. Paul Schools. And same thing happens with city council meetings. Okay. Way to go. That was fantastic of her. And you know what? I think one of the reasons she may have been able to stand up there is because those pastors stood up and she saw them doing that. You notice the room was empty? Is visitor's presentation, public comment, whatever, the room was empty. It was a school board meeting. It was empty. It's just terrible. Okay. To let you know that this is a cultural attack on Christianity that's going on, and trying to make it a legal attack too. In Canada, there's a music festival that's been going on for a number of years in Toronto, and Canada shut down the festival, and that basically calling into question is praising Jesus against the law. And the reason they canceled it is because Toronto called it proselytizing because of the words that were coming out on the songs that were being sung. So there's a lawsuit going on in that in Canada, but unbelievable. That was considered, proselytizing must be illegal in Canada now. So terrible stuff. All right. Harvard Law School, you know, these law schools will have various Supreme Court justices come in once in a while and give stories and talk and ask questions. And I remember being at the University of Minnesota when Clarence Thomas came in. That was fun. Got a picture with him. Told him about the corruption in Minnesota courts. And he goes, I don't know anything about that, do I? You know? And I go, no, you don't. Minnesota hides it really well. Got a picture when he's going, and when he's got the surprise look, what? You know, you're not accusing me, you know. No, I wasn't. I like Justice Thomas. But a student asks a great question. It's kind of hard to understand, but we'll go into that when it comes up. But he asks a great question of the Justice Kennedy. And really sticks him hard with a really significant question. So let's hear what he has to say.
Thank you again, Justice Kennedy, for being here. My name is Taryn Kane, I'm a 1L, and my question is about the public duty of, or the duty of public officials outside the judiciary. So as I understand your Obergefell opinion, you claim that new insights into the nature of marriage require states to issue marriage licenses in accord with this alternative version of marriage or understanding of marriage. And I can understand a similar case, probably more attractive to those of us who think that rational norms guide the exercise of sexual autonomy like they do economic autonomy. That would be that new insights into the nature of human life require states to take steps to stop abortions. My question would be, in either of these cases, would you say that
this is a huge question here. Do you understand this? Justice Kennedy's answer in the fake marriage decision, Obergefell, was part of his answer was, we have new insights into marriage. Of course, we don't have any new insights into marriage. This is a bunch of baloney on Justice Kennedy's part. So this guy gets up and says, well, we got new insights on abortion. So, you know, we're going to have a change in the abortion law. That's essentially the question he's asking, which is a great question because Kennedy is now trapped. This is a checkmate. Kennedy can only do one thing, and that's be rude. So let's see the rest of the question and then Kennedy's answer.
There are any state or federal officials with authority to act according to her own judgment of the truth of new insights or of the soundness of the court's constitutional interpretation? Or would it be illegal for any federal official or state official to enforce or to act according to the old understanding of life and the Constitution that she still judges to be the truth of the matter? Thank you very much.
The question was generally, what about, if I can rephrase it in a fair way, what is the duty of a public official if he or she cannot, in good conscience and consistent with their own personal and religious beliefs, enforce a law that they think is morally corrupt? Do you know how many judges do you think resigned in the Third Reich? Three. Great respect, it seems to me, has to be given to people who resign rather than do something they think is morally wrong in order to make a point. However, the rule of law is that as a public official, in performing your legal duties, you are bound to enforce the law. And it's difficult sometimes to see whether or not what you're doing is transgressing your own personal philosophy. This requires considerable introspection. And it's a fair question that officials can and should ask themselves. But certainly in an offhand comment, it would be difficult for me to say that people are free to ignore a decision of the Supreme Court. Lincoln went through this in the Dred Scott case. These are difficult moral questions. Mm-hmm.
Next one. Where's the microphone?
In the law, you have an ethical obligation. I did some domestic relation work in California. It's the community property was on the table, so it was you had accountants, and there was a big legal fees and this and so on. I had a client come, and he was one of my good business clients. He had a very substantial business and a sad divorce, which we couldn't seem to heal. And he said, now you ask for custody of the kids and then we'll get a better property settlement agreement. I said, I won't do that. He said, well, you're my lawyer, you have to do it. I said, man, go, you know, I'm not doing it. It seemed to me that this was just wrong. I wasn't going to put the kids'
welfare.
Happiness and welfare and good relations with both of their parents up on the block. And you just have to do this as an attorney. You have an ethical undertaking. And I seem to think this idea of ethical counseling is disappearing from the practice to some extent. Well, like I said, I had a divorce case, and it was a tremendous sum of money on either side, and we had a counseling attorney, and it was settled. And we had documents that they had to be signed. It was in my office with deeds and corporations and so forth. It was all settled. And they were in the middle of this settlement, and the husband said to the wife, and I'll be by Friday to pick up the banjo. She said, no, the banjo's mine. And she said, it was my Uncle Fred's. He said, but he gave it to you because I'm the one that played the banjo. So pretty soon, the attorneys look at each other. This settlement thing is going down over the banjo? And we took a recess, and the attorney on the other side, we agreed we could buy him five banjos. So we finally ended up, I was my solution was we had joint custody of the banjo. So you can work these things out.
Traveling banjo. Okay.
All right. This is disturbing, okay? And in a lot of ways, but kind of the thing here that really got to me is that he uses the phrase that you have an ethical responsibility, but then in his application of his practice, he applied his own ethics versus the client's ethics. He denies the consistency and application of the constitutional understanding of the law. He just gets it wrong here. So he says, I get to do my ethical responsibility, but you as citizens, you don't get to do yours. Is that what he's saying? Because he seemed not to, because when he brought up the Third Reich issue, only three judges resigned when the Third Reich came in, and that, you know, implying you still as a judge have to have a respect for the rule of law. Well, as a Supreme Court justice, he needs to have a respect for the rule of law, and he makes things up. He just totally makes things up out of thin air. And this student just nailed him, just creamed him to the ground, because the student never mentioned anything about religion. He talked about truth, but Kennedy brought in the religious aspect of this case. Okay, and the Kennedy tries to change the discussion very much here. If we got new information, as Kennedy says in gay marriage, fake marriage, then this kid says, we got new information about abortion. Okay, so we need to change things here. And that put Kennedy in a trap. This kid may be the one person that ends up, because he stood up and asked this poignant question, may be the one when an abortion case comes before the Supreme Court that Kennedy hears and realizes in order for him to be consistent, he will have to outlaw abortion because abortion's at life begins at conception. That's a huge, huge thing. All right. Good video. Good job on the guy. We're running out of time. I got some more issues, but go to Harvard Law School, and you can see that the full video going on there. But this guy really nailed Kennedy. Okay. Came out in the press. You know, we talk about the Gruzzini-Rukki case quite a bit here. And on my show, I've broken the issues in relationship to there's an underground system I've been told, I've read about, of because I've been involved in family law issues, that there's an underground system that if kids are being abused or they think they're being abused, that there's a system like the Underground Railroad that took blacks out of slavery. There's an underground railroad going on in child custody cases, whether parents think there's abuse or not, one parent may decide to use it anyway. We don't know until you have a fair hearing and a fair trial on these issues. You don't know. Brandon Stahl, who my understanding watches this show, I think picked up on that and actually did an article about this type of thing. And his article started out with, he's with the Star Tribune, Network of Family Court, the police said this, according to him, Network of Family Court critics is hiding Rukki's sister. Okay, well, that's a statement of fact coming from the police, The police are saying that is what's happening in this case. They don't know that. Okay, if they can be bold enough to say that this is happening by a network of family court critics, then they know who it is that has the girls, and they're not doing anything about it. That's just, otherwise, how can you say that? You know, so what Brandon Stahl does go in here, in the, this was dated November 3rd, and he did interview people that have been involved in this basically underground railroad. So there was somebody that was Jason Polinsky. Jason Polinsky was the police officer. But he talked about a vocal, passionate group, both in Minnesota and nationwide, that is sometimes called the Protect a Parent Movement. You know, I've never heard of that before, that Protect a Parent Movement. Those in the movement believe that family courts are broken and judges in custody disputes are ordering children to live with abusive parents. Some in the group say the non-custodial parent is, in these cases, has no choice but to hide kids in a loosely organized underground network. There are networks, little pockets throughout the country of abuse survivors who have dug in their heels and are forming an ad hoc shelter refuge for children, said Amy Newstein, a sociologist in New Jersey. So it's a great article. Go read it. He went out and discussed some of these issues. And people, you know, he mentioned that in this article that courts are kind of behaving badly in some situations. But he doesn't name Judge David Knutson as a bad actor, in which, in my opinion, he is a bad actor. But Sandra was arrested, I believe, at 1:30 in the morning. She woke up in Florida. That's the mother of the two missing girls, with guns pointed at her head, you know, fulfilling a search warrant. But just some of the details by my sources say that, you know, once she woke up, the guns were there, you know, at her head. But the girls weren't there. And so this is, and she's being charged with parental alienation, which there is a self-defense for parental alienation, which is one parent's being abusive or the parent in custody. But here's the deal, in the parental alienation charge, she's the parent and her ex-husband's the parent, but neither of them had custody at the time of the girls going missing. Okay, the girls are runaways. So this is a whole trumped up charge. And they said Sandra was missing, but Sandra wasn't missing. She was doing her flights. You know, they could find her, but a lot of her communication, because she had no money, she was broke. She had no money, very little to live off of, you know. It was a very, very tough situation for her. But they arrested her. She's been in jail. There's something like once the extradition papers are signed, they got 3 days to get her to Minnesota. I heard she left Friday. And then once you're in Minnesota, though, you got 48 hours to be in front of a judge. And as of yesterday, she hadn't been in front of a judge yet with her attorney. In other words, she can't communicate with anybody. She's not being able to communicate with anybody and or her past attorney. So it's a whole fiasco going on. And that's why I say it's very hard when you're arrested to get connected to the people you need to get to connected to, even if you already have it all arranged. She could be saying there, hey, Michelle McDonald's my attorney. She can be down there saying, I need to get a hold of her. It could be very, very difficult. So, and in that first appearance, within that 48 hours, a lot of liberties could be taken away because of games that get played in those situations. So That's just kind of an update, but I encourage you to read all of Brandon Stahl's article because you'll be more informed. You may be misinformed, you know, but you'll be more informed about what's going on in the case. But she is in town, should have an arraignment any time going on here. Around the area, Maplewood, the school district here, Tartan, North St. Paul, the referendum failed. And I think for a very clear reason is the financial mismanagement. Even with all the state money that came and Senator Wigger shoring up the retirement funding situation, I think people are just tired of North St. Paul. I mean, they're going to double their levy. Huge tax increase, just going for it all, mismanagement. Does this hurt the kids? No, the kids and the school will have the same amount of money and even more next year than they had this year. Okay, so nothing got hurt with not passing that levy increase. All right, so much we didn't get to on sexual abuse going on, which is part of our Common Core curriculum. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. The days go by, the forest sets on fire.